I confess it is a joy to see you today. I want to begin, this is the influence of my children on me, of watching The Simpsons. Anybody ever watch The Simpsons? I know. Who has not watched The Simpsons? Put up your hand. Keep them up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, a number of you have not watched The Simpsons. Well, the scene is Reverend Lovejoy. He's the minister, and he's really square. And he's the kind of guy who puts fun back in fundamentalism. So he's like an old school guy. And it's an evening church service, Sunday night, and there's nobody in church. And Homer walks in. Homer's words always, don't, don't. That's what Homer says all the time. He's not very smart. And Homer comes to church, and he's in the back pew, way back there. And Reverend Lovejoy says, well, it is all really good to see you today. At least one of you showed up. In light of the fact that it's Super Bowl Sunday, it's nice to see at least one person here in church. And Homer goes, don't, forgot it's Super Bowl. He gets up and he runs out of church. Today, Canadian history is being made. And we have a Canadian in the final of the Wimbledon Championships. And that's happening right now. So I've decided to not preach, and we're just going to put the game on the video. But actually, we did think of doing that, and a number of people at 9 o'clock were rather exercised by that, because they had purposely are taping the game at home, and they don't want to know the score, so we've decided not to put it on. So forgive me for that. I want to start today moving into this series I'm doing on the book of Galatians, and it's about freedom and the freedom that comes by faith. Reason I start there, it's just landing on me right now, okay? But when you make a commitment to God in the person of Jesus, and you're not, and you have not made that commitment. So you're on this side of the divide. This is the faithful, this is the seeker on this side, sorry. In order to make that leap, that piece of faith, from this side, to make that leap does not look or feel like freedom. It feels like restraint. It feels like a narrow road. It feels like I have to say yes to Jesus. Well, what about all this other stuff? And what I'm saying is that when you make a commitment, a serious commitment, like I'm signing up for Jesus, and that kind of commitment, what happens is emotionally, intellectually, and spiritually on the other side, you will in fact, even though it looks narrow from this side, you will experience more freedom than you have ever known. And that's part of the mystery of faith. And what I'm encouraging you to do, if you have not made that serious commitment, is to make that commitment. Because in the doing comes a joy and a new way of living. Yet, there will be times on this side when you read the paper and you look at Dallas, and people shooting people, police officers, people who, what went on in Minneapolis and is it Louisiana? It's staggering. And I think it weighs even heavier for a person of faith. Is that you realize that we're about the business of love and joy and peace and reconciliation, and yet there's all this violence. And so sometimes the walk doesn't feel like freedom. But what I'm suggesting is that there's a wisdom and an understanding. I'm going to make you work a little bit today and have you spend some time in Scripture. I introduce this with, I want you to understand the subtlety of words. If you're not asking good questions, you won't get good answers. And we think we understand, but then we're not really understanding in fullness. So let me just play with you with some notions of subtlety of words. Here's one that, try this one on. I don't want to stand out, but I want to be outstanding. Okay? Same words, just a little twist. I don't like to stand out. I don't hunger to stand in front of you to preach. I don't hunger to stand out that way. But if I do, I want to be outstanding. Those are subtle words. What about us as a people? Here's a subtlety that I shared with your leadership when we were on retreat last month. Jesus calls us to be fishers of men, right? We're supposed to be fishermen. Is that the primary motif that we should have? And I don't think it is. It is an important one, but as I talk to the leadership in my prayer, I think that we should be primarily about making disciples for Christ, which is actually a different thing than being a fisherman. A fisherman is bringing you into the kingdom of God. Here's what we do poorly. We bring people into faith, but once they've come to faith, the next question is, what do we do with them? Do you feed them? How do you make depth? That's discipleship. The word we're playing with is apprenticeship. We're playing with different words. But the ultimate point is that you need to become, it's one thing to say yes to Jesus, but you won't experience the freedom unless you get last week's sermon, which was about the work you have to do. Well, it's our job as the faithfully mature to help disciple the person who's new to the faith. So I'm suggesting discipleship needs to be our primary motive. Here's another thing. How many of you feel like, because being a fisherman kind of implies you're an evangelist, how many of you, there's a couple in here, who feel like they're evangelists? Do you are comfortable with being an evangelist? Put up your hand. There's one right there. Brian has got no problem talking to a tree about Jesus. He'll talk to anything about Jesus. Give him half an opportunity. How many of you feel comfortable evangelizing? There's a couple. 1, 2, 3, 4. Myself. Carol. 5, 6. Okay. Here's my point. Many of you are very devout, good Anglicans or Christians. And it's the last thing in the world you want to do is evangelize. Why is that? Well, maybe because it's not your spiritual gift. Traditionally, we've said, oh, we haven't taught you how to do it. And I'm going, well, maybe we have not taught you how to do it, but maybe it's not what you feel called to. You might want to talk about Jesus in a much subtler, quieter way. The precision is in the word. And I'm saying we need to be really clear about what we're asking of God. As a leader of this congregation, I think it's really important that I was taking the leadership of the church to say, we need to be looking more at our apprenticeship program. How do we apprentice people? How do we take people who are new to the faith and take them through a 3-year program or something? And there's a number of people meeting at my home this Tuesday night to discuss that very matter. But these are subtle points. Here's another one, and then I'll move to my text. But how about this one? I don't really care if we're a friendly church. But this is where I read about it. I would rather that we be a church where people make friends. Do you see the huge difference in that? Please tell me you do. Nod if you understand what I'm saying. You see, it's good to be friendly, okay? But we spend all this energy on being friendly. What I really think people need to do is this is a place where I can find a kindred spirit and a person where I can talk with and grow with and mature with. And therefore, I'll find myself coming to church because I know you're here and I get to hang out with you. That's a different culture, isn't it? And I think we need to try to encourage that. It's a subtle difference. But a lot of the language of church land is, we are a friendly church. Great. But what do you do with it? You see the difference? So that's where I go. So here's the next question that moves us to our title and our theme for the day. What are you really thirsty for? What are you really hungry for? The song that we sang, all who are thirsty, all who are weary, all who are weak. So I think it's the human condition. What is it that you really hunger for? I'm sitting on this because if you're not clear about the question, you're not going to get the answer. I've come to church. There's something inside me that's going, maybe I need to get to church. Maybe I got to find out what's going on. That's good. You're responding to something. But the clearer you are in your thinking about what you're after, the better off you'll be. And so I ask, what are you thinking and what are you after? Are you after stability? Security? How about a job? I know people are saying, I need a job. And I'm coming to church, I'm at my wit's end, and I'm just, God, I need a job. It's a valid prayer. But it's not the best prayer. And I got a best prayer for you. Because if you're thinking about all these other things, the ultimate peace is a relationship with God. A real, living relationship with God. And I'll tell you what the scriptures are telling us is that we need to be seeking God's Holy Spirit. And I'm not at all convinced that when you came to church today, you actually had clarity about, I'm after the Holy Spirit. I want God in my life. Now, we talk about coming to Jesus, and that's an important piece. It's a central piece. But when we come into the fullness of Christ, there is a gift given to us of the Holy Spirit. And it is a central piece. I'm going to move into the book of Galatians shortly. And you will not understand chapter 3 when I get into it unless you understand how clear it is in the mind of Peter and Paul and John and the early disciples that the pivot point for all of us is the anointing of the Holy Spirit. I mean, it's so important to that end, following today's service when we're having coffee and then we come back for a form of Q&A. I've asked Brian to be off in the chapel to be there to pray for anybody who specifically wants a calling of God's Holy Spirit upon them. I need to raise a few pieces with you before we get into Galatians to understand the centrality of this. I want you to know that it was not St. Paul who came up with this. This is what Jesus is teaching, and Paul follows up on it. Now, I was told by a parishioner it would be really good if you did not put the page number on there, just say Luke 11, so that you can find it on your own. Because you got to learn how to find these things on your own. It's in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It's the third book of the New Testament. And I read from chapter 11. I do encourage you to look it up, because as you do, you will learn more. I read from verse 9. Here's Jesus. The context is perseverance in prayer. And he says, so I say to you, ask and it will be given you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be open. Now, before I move on, the door will be open. I cannot help but look. Some of you all know this, but I can't help. I don't make reference to stained glass windows very often. This is Holman Hunt's Jesus knocking at the door from the book of Revelation. This is the most popular piece of art in the Western world, in Europe and North America in the 1900s. There's three originals were like done, and they're small, and they toured, and people would come and line up at museums and galleries all over to see this. This is the most replicated piece of stained glass in any of all churches throughout the world. Because it makes reference to the book of Revelation, but it's Jesus knocking at the door. But I've said this before, and some of you know this, but I'm going to repeat it because it's important. Note in the original, it's got green leaves all over it, vines. In the original, you can barely see the door for the vines that have overgrown. Symbolic, the door hasn't been open in a while. And a huge piece is there's no door handle on that door. Significance? The door handle's on the inside where you are, and you're the one who has to open the door. Jesus is not barging in to your life. You open the door and invite him in. He's knocking. But we're so busy, we don't hear him. So this is Luke 9. And you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks, receives. And everyone who searches, finds. Are you searching? Sincerely searching. And for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. If there's anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish. Or if the child asks for an egg, will you give the child a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give you the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Okay. My kids come to me and they ask for something. I am doing my utmost to find how to say yes. Even if I'm not spiritual, I get that. I want to help my kids. It's a biological thing. It's a family thing. Jesus said, even you who are evil, that's what the text said, who are fallen, who is selfish, even you're smart enough to give your children good stuff. Guess what? How much more so will God in heaven give you the motorboat that you've been asking for? Did I just say that? You see, Jesus doesn't really give a hill of beans about a motorboat. Now, there might be some people who preach that, but I'm not preaching that. Notice that the text says, those who seek the Holy Spirit. That's the punchline. Are you seeking? And so, what are you thirsty for? Sometimes we're just thirsty for relief. And he's saying, no, I want to give you this. The life of the church, the life of the Christian is grounded in this mysterious gift. And you need to hunger for it. If you're not hungering for it, and then you're wondering why you're limping in your spiritual walk, don't wonder any longer. It's a gift that comes from God. John chapter 14. One more. I'm in verse 15 of chapter 14. John. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Verse 16, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another, an advocate, to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive. You see, as I am preaching, there are people right now who I know who are not hearing me. What I'm saying is actually, okay, he's talking about the Holy Spirit, that's really cool, and you've already wandered. What I'm suggesting, if you're wandering, I'm suggesting at a spiritual level, notwithstanding my inability to communicate it, the point is that the Holy Spirit is to those, it is spiritually discerned. Spiritual things are discerned in your spirit. Worldly things are discerned in the flesh. You need to say, where's my spirit? What's my spirit hungry for? And the big league, the graduate school, is the Holy Spirit. The world cannot receive. That means there are many people walking around this world who do not have the Holy Spirit within them. That's what it says. Because it neither sees him, the Holy Spirit, nor knows him. But you know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. This is the pivotal point of Christianity. It is, you know, the pivot point, of course, is Christ, his death, and his resurrection. But our ability to understand it and discern it comes only by the Holy Spirit. That's how, and it's received, and it's a gift from God. So you don't need to turn to it. Acts chapter 2, the early church, the disciples, they come, and there's this Holy Spirit comes upon them as a group. I'll pray today, the Holy Spirit will all come upon you as a group, and you'll all be dancing and singing, and you'll never know what's going on. I thought we were Anglicans. We don't do that. But yes, that's how the Holy Spirit works. Okay. In Acts chapter 8, there's this, no, it's not 8. Yeah, it is. Acts 8, 14 to 17. Some people up in Samaria received the word of Jesus. They get converted. Sounds nice? The guys in Jerusalem, Peter and James and John, they hear that they got converted up in Samaria. What do they do? In Acts 8, 14 to 17, just as you want to write it down, they hop on a bus, they get on their motorcycle, they didn't have motorcycles back then, and they drive up to Samaria, and they say, Andrew, we heard that you've accepted Jesus. And you went, yeah. And then they said, but have you heard of the Holy Spirit? And they said, no. So they laid hands on them so they would receive the Holy Spirit. Guess what the crisis in the church is? We do baptisms in those fonts in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. My hunch is that most people are doing a baptism of John. They have not received the Holy Spirit. I can't give you the Holy Spirit. You need to receive the Holy Spirit from God. I can point to it. I can say, open the door. But we need to be anointed by the Spirit of God. The Scriptures, the reason I've told you about this story in Acts is to tell you the story of the Holy Spirit is all through this book. So now the question is, as we turn to Galatians, here's the question. Do you want to strive through life or do you want to thrive through life? Just before I move to Galatians, here's the piece. I think most of you are striving through life instead of thriving through life. Thriving in your sailboat. I got this image of a sailboat. I don't know how many of you are sailors with the sail full of wind, and it just guides you along. You don't have to do much work. You just have to control, guide it. But the Spirit is that wind. But I talk to all sorts of people who are also Christians who are not living in the Spirit. They say yes to Jesus, but they're not living in the Spirit. And what's happening is your life is still a chore. And I'm saying if your life's a chore, somehow you're missing something. It's the Spirit of God. Now, Galatians 3, 1 to 9. Let's take a look. If you're visiting with us, know that we have been doing a Bible series in the book of Galatians about freedom. This is the sixth or seventh in the series, and we're now in chapter 3. Here's what he says. Paul's writing to the church. So if you're a visitor, here's this. I've used it before. Galatia is like Ontario. Galatia is a province. He says this, you foolish Ontarians. That's what he's saying, okay? Just so it's not too remote. Who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited and crucified. The only thing I want to learn from you is this. Did you receive the Spirit? You see the focus here? How did you? Did you receive the Spirit by doing works of the law or by believing what you heard? So the assumption in the text is you need the Holy Spirit. If I had just started here, I don't think you would have got that. That's why I've spent the first part of my sermon talking about the centrality of the Holy Spirit. Now the question is, how do you receive it? Anybody want to know how to receive it? Did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Verse 3, are you so foolish? Having started with the Spirit, which implies you can lose the Spirit, are you now ending with the flesh? Did you experience so much for nothing? If it really was for nothing? Well, then, does God supply you with the Spirit and work miracles among you by you doing the works of the law or by your believing what you heard? You receive the Spirit by faith. And I believe faith is ostensibly offensive to the natural man. I think natural people kind of go, faith, blind faith, I don't want to have faith, I want to be an idiot. You're telling me to park my brain at the door. And I'm saying, no. Faith is full of intellect and spirit. It is your very fullness of being is your faith. And that faith, but here's the problem. We turn Christianity into rules all the time, so much so that Paul had to write an entire letter to the Church of Ontario, Galatia, to say, folks, don't fall prey to living by law. And we do it all the time. You got to live in that freedom of the Spirit. He even wants to make the point so clear to you. He says in verse 6, just as Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, so you see those who believe are the descendants of Abraham. So this may be too basic for some of you who know so much, but I want to make sure everybody gets this. So I'm sorry for being so simple, but here goes. Abraham, Old Testament. Abraham is in the, his name is Abram, and he lives in the land of Ur. You are, Euphrates, those two rivers over there. And he hikes because God gives him a message in Genesis 12, Genesis 15, Genesis 17. God speaks to Abraham and says, I will make you, you will be my people, I will be your God, you be my guy. And I will give you as many descendants as the stars in the sky. Can you count all the stars in the skies, Abraham? And Abraham goes, no. He first hears it when he's 75. He's got no children. And they finally have a child. Abraham and Sarah have a child. Abraham and Isaac, when he's 90 years old. So God waited 15 years, made him do a rethink. We touched on that last week. Everything goes in slow motion. It took him 15 years, and Abraham gets the message. How did he get it? He believed in God. He said, okay, God. Everything was counter to logic. He had no children. His wife was beyond childbearing years, right? She's 90 years old. Got to break it to you, God. It's called menopause. Sorry. Unless there's a miracle. And she gives birth to Isaac. And Isaac means laughter. It's a joke. God, Abraham and Sarah, they're so amazed they have a child. They laugh. That's what you think. You're kidding me. We'll call him Isaac, which means humor, laughter. Okay. So here's the point. He got it by faith. He didn't follow a bunch of rules. You need to do the same. It's as simple as surrender. But surrender is probably the most difficult thing you'll ever do. And so he cites this. It is by faith that we're saved. By faith, this understanding comes and the Holy Spirit comes. And we will wander and be separated. Let me leave you with one last thought. For freedom that comes by faith, real freedom comes by faith. When he cites Abraham, just as Abraham believed, and this is my last point, I didn't learn until about 15 years ago, and it really helped me. So I'm hoping this will help you. High practical application. Just as Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Don't put up your hand. How many of you try to be righteous? In the best sense of the word. I know I do. I want to live a righteous life. I want to be a good person. I want to do things that are pleasing to God. Does that not make sense? So what happens is you end up following rules. You say, okay, God, don't commit adultery, Drew. That's a good one. Don't do that. Don't steal. Yeah, don't kill mom and dad. Honor mom and dad. I end up following rules. The Bible said, God smiled on Abraham and considered Abraham righteous because of faith. It's faith that makes God smile on you, not your actions. Actions are good. You want to do good things. It's a really important piece. When I'm living in the world and I got a tough decision before me, and I go, okay, what am I going to do? I make up my mind and I go make a decision. Not good, Drew. Not good. What I need to do is say, I think I better pray about this. And I pray and I wait on the Lord. And all of a sudden, I have an enlightenment that says, go here instead of there. I still might be wrong. I love that. But I've made a choice, and I've made my choice in faith. I believe in faith that God called me to haunt all of you at St. John's York Mills 10 years ago. Okay? It was by faith I believed I was supposed to come here. It is by faith. And when you do that, when you live in faith, because I walk in all the decisions I make in my life, if I offer them over to God and ask for the Holy Spirit, God will guide me in the decisions that I will make. And guess what? When I act on those, even if I do it poorly, God looks at that and says, you are righteous. Not because you're so good. It's because you're living by faith. Live by faith and God will smile upon you. Live by faith and you will experience freedom as you've never experienced before. Amen.